Welcome to StormCast, the official Warhammer Age of Sigmar podcast.
I'm Wade Price, and my Warcry is Welcome to StormCast. Today, I am very pleased to welcome back onto the show games developer Sam Pearson, here to talk about the development of the new brutal skirmish game set in the Mortal Realms, Warcry. Hey, Sam.
Hi, Wade.
Welcome back to StormCast.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to be on again.
Well, it was a fantastic performance the last time. We had a wonderful chat about the making of Battletomes.
Yes.
But you were keeping something to yourself when you came and talked to us the last time.
Yes, so I was busy working
really
on this at the time.
You were, and you kept that to yourself. So we're recording this at a point in time. People don't need to know about it, but this should be going out in the world when Warcry is really being talked about. So this is a great opportunity to share everything that you know that you're allowed to share about the development of Warcry.
Because very exciting.
This was your thing for quite a while.
I was involved in Warcry for a very, very long time. So it's really exciting to finally have it sort of revealed to the wide world. And I think I've seen people are very excited on the on the internet and the community in general. So that's really great to hear.
Did you have to engage in any sort of brutal gladiatorial combat to determine who would be the writer for this project?
Yes, and I pinned Jervis to the floor in a headlock.
Ages ago.
No, definitely not. I would definitely lose if we had a gladiatorial fight. I think once played a Blackstone Fortress against Jervis, and he beat me up in the lift inside the maglift chamber. So one of the stories I like telling. So I like to think it would translate in real life as well.
He's a big fella.
Yes,
pretty handy. So what would you like the world to know about Warcry? What is it?
Yeah, well, let's start from the beginning. So it's a skirmish game for Age of Sigmar. And what we mean by that is, rather than mustering a grand army that you're going to be fighting sort of a pitched battle with, you're instead mustering a small war band of fighters. And each of these will have names and things like that. And you'll be engaged in battles against other war bands. The game is set in the Eight Points. So that is sort of the nexus, the hub between the realms. So it's a very, very exciting location to set the game. Because it means we've got these warbands vying for power out in there. Some of them are on a quest towards the Baron Spire, and some of those are on quest to do other things, which we might talk about a little bit later.
Okay.
So it's a skirmish game. So you could consider it as the next step along from Age of Sigmar Skirmish. So if you've enjoyed Warhammer Age of Sigmar Skirmish, this is the thing for you.
Mm-hmm.
It's also the equivalent of Kill Team for Age of Sigmar. Mm-hmm. So we go much more in depth into the rules, and it's got its own bespoke rule system like Kill Team does in relation to Warhammer 40,000. And then lastly, I think you could say it's the spiritual successor to some of our older games like Mordheim. So if you were a fan of Mordheim back in the day, then this is going to be the book for you. And that's because, as well as being able to use existing factions from Age of Sigmar, it's got its own bespoke warbands in it, which we'll talk about a little bit later, I imagine.
You're saying all of my favourite words right now. I have long maintained that Mordheim was my favourite Games Workshop game forever, but I reckon this might be about to knock it off the perch.
We've got a really, really exciting setting for it. And I mean, in some ways, saying it harkens back to Mordheim, it also harkens back further, back to things like the Realm of Chaos books, Slave to Darkness, Lost in the Damned. When we perhaps talk about the design process a little bit on, I can mention that we went back to those books and pulled out some core elements. So if you're a fan of those books from the 80s, so for the veteran gamers among you, then you'll see lots of familiarity in here as well. So the game oozes Warhammer, I think. It's a real, real essence of Warhammer. And it's just really exciting to bring a new fully fleshed skirmish system to Age of Sigmar.
Yeah. So how did it all come about? What was the first step in the project?
Yep, so the first step in any project is always the miniatures. So we started seeing images of the warbands that the miniatures guys were producing. And I had the pleasure, part of my job was to look through Jess Goodwin's sketches. He's got loads and loads of sketches about how the different weapons for the warbands work, how they were crafted, things like that, really, really in detail stuff. Got to start seeing the photos and the renders of the miniatures come up from the sculptors. So then we started to talk about what we wanted to do as a game. So to begin with, when we design a game like this in the studio, we have a bit of research and development, or R&D as we call it. So that was headed by Mr. Jervis Johnson, no less.
Mm-hmm.
And he put together a prototype for this game. And then once the prototype was agreed upon and things like that, and we got the go ahead for the game, then it was given to me. And I was super happy because this was my dream job to make a skirmish game for Age of Sigmar. And it got given to me to turn into a fully realized product. So then I got to work on it for the next few months, perhaps even longer than that, It was a very, very long time putting together a big book like this and all of the content that goes with it. And now it's coming out in the future. Yeah, and I almost can't believe it's a real thing, but here it is.
So I imagine there would have been some tweaks from the engine that Jervis first put together and the game that you worked on. But what would you say what struck you about Jervis's system when it was first presented?
So a lot of the core elements of Jervis's prototype went into the final game. So going into the game mechanics, so the game is alternate activation. And what we mean by that, if you're not familiar with the term, is you take a turn activating a single model in your warband, and then your opponent takes a turn activating a single model. So there is no movement phase, shooting phase, combat phase, things like that, as you would expect in Age of Sigmar and Warhammer 40,000. Instead, you pick one of your models, you make two actions with them. Mm-hmm. That could be move, could be fight, could be move, could be fight, could be one of the other actions. There are four in total to choose from, and then it goes straight over to your opponent. So that was a core part of Jervis's prototype to begin with, and it led to really fast and dynamic gameplay, which we really liked. The other thing was that the battle plans are generated with a system similar to the Open War cards. So there are four decks of cards, your terrain card, your deployment card, your victory card, and your twist card, and that generates the game that you're going to be playing.
Great.
So the initial idea was in there from Jervis's prototype, and then I had to expand it out, so we made 36 cards in each deck, which leads to, the twist deck has got a few, well, it's got twists in it, actually means that there's over 31 million combinations of games, so you're going to really struggle to play the same game twice, I think. You'd have to be incredibly lucky.
But you've playtested all those variations.
Yeah, of course. Well, we definitely playtested, we went through a long period of playtesting and going through all of the cards and doing it as rigorously as we could.
Sure.
And we've also got we'll talk about it a little bit later, but the card decks, some of them are designated for match play and some of them are designated for narrative play, or you can have them all together if you wish, which is the way I like to play. Mm. And we definitely focused on the ones that we wanted to be for, although it's a narrative game, first and foremost, we wanted to focus on the deployments and the victory conditions that worked well for match play to make sure that they were balanced as possible as well. So those were some of the early parts of Jervis's prototype, and one of the last things was the way the campaign system works. Mm. So we can talk about that later on in detail, but in a sense, your warband embarks upon a campaign quest, and that is a narrative story goal that you're trying to achieve. So it's exciting because we've not quite done that in our older skirmish games. Mm. You would embark on a campaign with you and your friends, but there wouldn't really be an end goal to it. You would just be playing and having fun, and it would eventually sort of peter out after a few months or so. Whereas here, there is a campaign quest that you can strive for to complete. When you complete it, that's not the end, of course. You can either choose to lord it over your territory that you've amassed and with your extra points that you're able to bring to each game, or you can choose to go on to a new campaign quest. But it does mean that you have these goals that you're working towards all the time. And what's exciting about that is because the campaign quest is personal to you, it means that if you don't have a regular gaming group, you can go down to your Games Workshop store or your friendly local gaming store, and you can just find somebody else that's also on a campaign quest of their own, challenge them for a battle, your two warbands meet out in the wilderness, and from there maybe the next week you'll play somebody else. So it makes the campaigns a bit more personal, something that you and your warband embark upon.
Much like if you were just roaming around the Mortal Realms, looking for someone to fight, you could just encounter them and fight them.
Yeah, 100%. So those were some of the core facets of Jervis's prototype, and then it was given to me the task of turning it into a fully fleshed game. And there was lots of room for me to put my own spin on things as well, which I really, really enjoyed.
Okay.
Should we talk about the box?
Please
and
do,
everything
yes.
that you get? So inside the box of Warcry, you get everything you need to play the game. So you get this 160-page rule book that I'm holding out in front of me for people listening on the podcast. You get two warbands within. Mm-hmm. So those are the Iron Golem and the Untamed Beasts. Both of them have a very, very different feel. So the Iron Golem, they hail from Shimon, from the realm of metal, and their sort of motto is, we create war. So they are the blacksmiths and the armorers, and they think that they are the best at that. They create the finest weapons and the finest armor. And they are questing into the Baron Spire because they want to be the armorers for Archeon himself. They want to be the guys that make the armor plates for the Varangard and things like that.
It's a prestigious job.
Yeah, so that's what they're on their quest to get to the center of the 8 points and arrive at the Varanspire to do so. Mm-hmm. On the flip side, you've got the Untamed Beasts, which hail from Gur. They're very nomadic, very bestial in appearance. They wear lots of pelts and furs and their weapons made out of bones. These guys are much more savage and they're looking to, their motto is to hunt the hunter. So they want to hunt down the savage beasts and things like that and prove themselves worthy of joining Archeon's cause to do that. So you've got these two opposed warbands. Very, very fun because they're stylistically very different to look at. So I think everybody's got their favorite if they like the Iron Golem or they like the Untamed Beasts. For me, I like the Iron Golem. Okay. Absolutely love them. So my warbands that I've been playing so far in our studio campaigns have all been Iron Golem warbands. They play very differently as well. So the Iron Golem, the guys are heavily armored. So when we talk about the mechanics later, they've got a high toughness value. For Age of Sigmar players, you might be excited at me saying toughness value, but we'll get more into that later. So they've got high toughness. They're a little bit slower. They hit hard. They hit brutally. On the flip side, you've got the Untamed Beasts, which are more nimble, agile. They're a little bit more fragile, but they are able to unleash the beast. It's one of their abilities where they sort of have this primal savage fury that they're able to call upon to help bring down their enemies. So two exciting ways to play. So you get two warbands in there. Both of those warbands clock in at just under 1,000 points. So when we talk about the game, you need 1,000 points to play a standard game of Warcry. Later on in the campaign, you might be able to muster a few more points depending on the amount of territory you've dominated. But for the most part, you're going to be playing a 1,000 point game, so never playing any less. So you've got two full warbands straight away. Those are not the only miniatures you get in the box.
Go on.
So you also get some new Furies and yes. some Raptorixes. Yeah. So Furies are classic miniatures reimagined, and they just look fantastic. They look really, really good. The Raptorixes are something new as well, so it's really exciting seeing this chaotic fauna that would exist out in the realms. So you get six Furies and six Raptorixes. Now, sometimes those will be roaming chaotic beasts that will just appear on your battlefield, and they're not allied to either warband, so they'll just be causing havoc all over the place. Other times, once your warband has started to raise monoliths, so as you start winning games, you get to raise monoliths, dominate territory, you'll be able to thrall these creatures into your warband. So if you're playing a campaign system, you've actually got some miniatures to add into your warband straight away later as it develops, because you can start adding in these Furies and Raptorixes. For fans of older games like the Realm of Chaos, Slaves to Darkness and Lost in the Damned, you should be very excited hearing about Chaos Monoliths and hearing about thralling creatures into your warband. These were ideas that are sort of core ideas to Chaos dating back from the 80s that we brought forward into Warcry, so that was really fun to do.
Have you created a monolith yet? Have you scratch built your own monolith?
No, I've not, but I've been eyeing up the Beast of Chaos Herdstone, because I think customizing that a little bit could create it. Yep. What's exciting about the background for the book is it talks about the different monoliths that you make. As well as getting all of the miniatures, you get all of the terrain. So the terrain is completely brand new as well. So it's a ruined city set. So just to talk about the 8 points. So the 8 points are dating back to the Age of Myth. It used to be called the All Points. And it wasn't a place of tyranny and evil like it is now. It was a nexus for trade, because it's a continent-sized landmass that connects to all of the different realms through the different realm gates that it has. And that meant it was sort of a cosmopolitan hub, able to bring in different cultures from all of the different mortal realms. But then when Chaos set in the Age of Chaos, Archeon decided it was the perfect place to set up his bastion, the Varanspire, and be able to coordinate his attacks to dominate the mortal realms. So it's now, it's a place that's lost its grandeur that it once had. It's fallen from glory, and you really, really see that in the terrain. So the hobby products team that make all of our terrain, they did a fantastic job. So you'll see there's a desecrated statue of Sigmar where the head is just toppled down. It looks very, very cool. And you see all of the ruins, they've become very dilapidated, and they've since been built upon with wooden scaffolding and things like that. So it very much looks like a long lost civilization that's been destroyed, and now these warbands are fighting out amongst the ruins. So it's a very exciting location. location.
Perfect for scrambling over and cinematic fight scenes.
Yeah, yeah. So when we talk about the rules later on, all of the I took special care in making sure that the movement rules were really exciting. So being able to climb up stuff, leap from building to building, jump down, and things like that, to really get the most out of that scenery. You get a board as well that you play on. If you're familiar with Kill Team, the board is the same size as Kill Team, so it's approximately 22 inches by 30 inches. So we call this a small footprint game. So that was another one of the core concepts that we had when we approached the game, is we wanted it to be able to play on a small size and be able to play on a coffee table, or if you go to, if you're lucky to live in Nottingham, you go to Bugman's. Yep. And play out on the tables in Bugman's. So you get the board, and it's double-sided. So on one side you have sort of a dark and gray environment that looks great with the terrain. On the other side you get a sort of a dusty feel, and if you wanted to sort of paint, you, we've got one set of terrain that we sprayed with Zandri dust to begin with, and that looks great on the other side as well. So very exciting. And then as well as that, you get all of your tokens, you get your fighter cards, I think you get range rulers, you get dice, you get everything that you need to play the game. So it's an absolutely jam-packed box. I think we've just got it behind me. Mm-hmm. I think it's one of the thickest boxes we've ever made.
Pretty hefty, yeah.
And so every plastic frame in there, so from the miniatures to the scenery, is brand new. And it's got everything that you need. So it's got the book, the counters, the dice, all of the cards as well, I should mention, so to generate your battlefield. Mm. It's a very exciting product to bring out.
Delighted to see the finished
cycles. Yeah, I couldn't believe it. Yeah, and it's been so great to see it all come together. Yeah. Lots of hard work. So I was the lead designer for the rules, but there was a whole team working on it. So we had Nick Horth doing the background. Mm-hmm. You might have heard his name before, because he writes lots of Black Library novels, as well as being a background writer for Age of Sigmar. So the background novels that he writes, he's famous for City of Secrets, yep. Callis and Toll, Heart of Winter. So the books that he writes often focuses on the sort of the ground level of the Mortal Realms. Mm-hmm. So it was really great to have him working here, which is definitely on the ground level of chaos in the Mortal Realms. So he did all of the background, and I've got a very talented team of artists and layout and photography, and our editors as well, that all worked really, really hard on this book together.
We've seen some of the environmental art that you know, sets the scene for the settings of your Battles of Warcry. Who put those pictures together?
Yeah, so the Paul Dainton did a lot of the artwork in the book, and looking through it really, really inspired me when I was writing the rules. So in a lot of the art pieces, you see fighters leaping across sort of large gaps, across canyons, climbing up the terrain and the wall. So what I wanted when I was making the is to reflect that in the rules. When you're moving in Warcry, for example, you're able to leap from any building to another, as long as you've got move value left. So you don't need to roll a dice and you fall down if you fail. So you can leap across lots of your buildings. You can climb up any wall unopposed as well. I wanted to give the game almost a parkour feel. I felt that these Chaos Warriors, or any fighter in Age of Sigmar, would be able to run up to these walls, scramble up them very quickly. And it makes the game very dynamic to play. Often when I'm designing rules, I'll start at the end goal of where I want to be. So looking at that artwork that Paul put together, I had this mental picture of a fighter leaping across a building, climbing up the wall the other side, and then whacking somebody off the top. Well, that sounds pretty cool. Let's make sure you can do that in the game. And that's exactly what you can do. So it was very, very, very fun.
You'd like to think the trek to reach the setting would have weeded out some of the less physically able members of these warbands.
Just moving on to the setting, actually, it's very exciting, because we get a real in-depth look at the 8 points, but we see it very much from the ground level. The 8 points, you've got these, we've known so far that you have these big realm gates that are able for Archaon to send his armies out into the Mortal Realms. And those are incredibly dangerous sort of places to go through, those realm gates. There are big highways leading off from the Baron Spire that go out in all directions, like an eight-pointed star, that lead into each of the realms. So getting through one of those realm gates, I think that's going to be a bit of a tall order. Mm-hmm. So you're not able to sneak armies into the 8 points, I think these low, sort of small-scale warbands, you are able to sneak in. So it's not just Chaos that are able to get in there as well. So we've got all of the Chaos warbands that are in the game, but we've also got existing Age of Sigmar factions. Great. That are in here, and they have campaigns in this book as well.
Okay.
For example, the StormCast Eternals, they're They've got some of the Vanguard Chamber sort of hunting around the wilderness of the 8 points. They're on a search for a Storm Vault, which is something that we've seen in Forbidden Power. So there's a Storm Vault sacristy that they're hunting down, hoping to retrieve the powerful artifacts within before it falls into the hands of Chaos. So that's just one example of the struggles that other factions might have and the motivations for them coming into the 8 points. Now, the Warcry book only focuses on a small segment. So it focuses on something called the Bloodwind Spoil. So if you think about the Varen Spire in the middle, the great big tower, and these massive highways that stretch over, that wouldn't be something that warbands would be able to sneak over those highways because they've constantly got armies coming over. So that creates the space in between these highways. And one of those segments is called the Bloodwind Spoil. And that's where we focus the story for this Warcry book. The Bloodwind Spoil is a vast, vast place in of itself. It's got mountain ranges in multiples, it's got forests, it's got lakes. These are all very twisted versions though, so they might be lakes of blood, they might be gnarled forests that attack you as you go within, and so on. So it's got a very, very varied landscape. It's got lots of its own cities and settlements as well, and that's really exciting to look at what does a Chaos city look like. So we've got a Khanguard in here, which is one of the Chaos city that we focus on. They're not very nice places to live, you know, these are cities built on tyranny and slavery and things like that, but they are functioning cities nonetheless, and that's very exciting to explore. So there's lots of when you're looking through this book, it's 160 pages, and we dedicate the start to there's really evocative bits of art. So you get to see the environment, what it's like to fight in. You get these very cool silhouettes of the different Chaos warbands that are within, and their motto and bits about them, where they hail from, and so on. And then it goes into the rules.
Cool. Yeah. Well, one of the most exciting things about Warhammer Age of Sigmar recently, I think, has been looking at the various factions and how each of the battle tomes and products like this allow us to look at each faction from their own perspective. Mm. And for so long, Chaos has been presented as the enemy. And they're not always the enemy. They're just humans trying to get by sometimes.
Yeah, I think that's the most exciting thing. So so if we think about these Chaos warbands, a lot of them, they were... You know, they had to turn to like dark powers, or they had to get power from somewhere to survive. Mm. So they were the ones that were abandoned. And when the Age of Myth ended and the Age of Chaos began, they were the peoples that weren't able to make it back to Azaheim. They were left in the realms. And so what do? You need to adapt to be able to survive. And some of the Chaos warbands, because it's on such a ground level, they might not quite have an idea of what Chaos is in its entirety. They might not know of the four different Chaos gods, or five if you include the Horned Rat. So they worship perhaps, well, there's one of them, the Splinter Fang, that worship a god beast, for example, there's the Iron Golem. We don't know if they align to any of the gods at all. They're much more focused on being able to forge their own weapons, and rumor has it that they have a sun dragon that's they've enslaved within their own mountain that creates all the magmic energy that they're able to forge their own weapons with. So we get to see Chaos being much more nuanced and much more gray than it previously has been.
I guess whether those statements are true or not, it tells you something of the other warbands that spread those rumors about the other warbands, that they might have a god or might have a dragon or something like that. Cool, that tells you some stories.
Yeah, really exciting.
So should we talk a bit more about the rules?
Yes, let's get into it.
A new bespoke rule set.
So the game is a small footprint game. So it takes place on a board which is the same size as a Kill Team board, for those of you that are familiar with Kill Team. So that's 22 inches by 30 inches. So it takes place on a board. And each of the... To start off with, you'll be mustering a warband each. So if you're playing a campaign game or a match play game or an open play game, you'll be mustering a warband to a points value, and that is 1,000 points. So 1,000 points will usually get you around 8 or 9 fighters. For example, the two warbands inside the core box, the Iron Golem and the Untamed Beast, both clock in at just under 1,000 points. And the same with all of the other bespoke warbands that are coming out. So getting a chance to rebuild a points value, a point system from the ground up, meant I could look at each of the warbands, how they were coming, and make sure that when the players bought a box, it gave them everything they need to start their campaign. So you muster your warbands to 1,000 points, and to do that, that. Every single warband, every fighter in your warband has a fighter card, and that gives you all the information that you need to know about the fighter. So it's got their move characteristic, their toughness characteristic, their wounds characteristic, and then it's got any rune marks, which we'll talk about in just a sec, which decide what sort of special abilities they can do. Okay. And lastly, it's got any of their weapons that they can attack with. And it's got their points value up at the top as well. So you muster your warband up to 1,000 points, and then you're ready to start playing. You're going to generate a battle plan using the battle plan cards. But before you do so, you need to separate your warband into three battle groups. Okay. And you need to do it before you generate the scenario, because it's an unknown entity which fighters will start on the war on the battlefield, which ones will start in reserve to come in later. So the three battle groups is the dagger, the shield, and the hammer. And you need to, there's a few rules on how you separate your fighters. You need to have the most in the shield, for example. But you separate your fighters into these three distinct groups, and then you're ready to start generating the battlefield. So you do that before you know the game that you're going to play. Then you turn over a terrain card, you turn over a deployment card, you turn over a victory card, and you turn over a twist card. So the terrain card shows you the layout of the terrain, and it's got an orientation on it, so you know which way is pointing north. So you get your terrain from your collection and you set it up. The terrain that you get from the box, it is modular, so you can build it any way you want. It does give you a recommendation on how to get it to match the terrain cards, but also in the core rules, if you want to build it your own way, there's rules in the core rules on how to swap out your bespoke pieces for the ones on the map. So you can build your terrain any way you want. Once you've set up the terrain, you then look at the deployment card, and that's going to show you which of your battle groups, so your shield, your dagger, or your hammer, will start on the battlefield and which ones will go into reserve.
Does that represent your warband kind of split up, wandering around?
Exactly, yeah. So the way I like to think about it is your dagger could be things like your scouts or things like that, because your dagger is the one that thrusts first if you're doing attacking motion. Your shield is sort of like your main body, because that then blocks the enemy's counterattack, and then the hammer is the killing blow that comes at the end. So that's the way that I like to play, but we leave it a bit more vague. So you have your, so there's no, you don't need to say put your leader in one, for example. Your leader can go in any of these. But the reason we chose to do this from a design perspective is we wanted the game to be small footprint, but we didn't want it to lead to a big melee in the center. So we wanted it to be really dynamic and use the different space everywhere on the board to its maximum potential. So what that means is you might start with your two, just say your two daggers faced off in the center. And then you might have your hammer coming in sort of the north northwest. You might have your shield coming in the southeast. So what that means is your warbands are going to be all over the board by sort of battle round three, and that's going to lead to different pockets of fighting happening. So there will be multiple fronts, and it really maximizes the space that's available. The victory cards. So they're either based on, some of them are treasure, trying to capture treasure, loot, things like that. Some of them are trying to score objectives, so much more traditional sort of match play sense. Some of them are trying to assassinate certain characters, maybe an enemy leader, maybe you're trying to take out the enemy dagger, things like that. And the others are about maneuvers, so trying to get past the enemy, break through the enemy line. So there's a lot of variety in there. Yeah. 36 of each of these cards, by the way. And then lastly, you've got your twist. So your twist can be things like weather effects. There's a big joke in the office because I love my weather tables. I put weather effects into Beasts of Chaos, into Fire Slayers, into things like that. So here again, they are in Warcry, but good. I find it very evocative.
Yeah.
There's more magical phenomenon that can happen. So you can have an Azurite lightning storm, things like that, which is quite exciting. There are the different chaos gods can have a sort of, can look upon the battlefield. So you might have the Winds of Change from Tzeentch, you might have a Blood Wind from Khorne, things like that affecting different ways. The twist might be psychological, so it might be a grudge match between the two enemy leaders and so on. Or they might bring on the Furies and the Raptorixes as almost like NPCs on the battlefield, so unaligned fighters that might attack anybody at any moment. So that decides your game, and then you're ready to play. So you're going to get lots and lots of variety out of it. Now, once you're playing the game is played in battle rounds. To start off with, the players have a hero phase. And in the hero phase, you each roll your initiative dice. So there are six initiative dice that each player rolls. And you roll your six initiative dice, and you're looking for your singles, your doubles, your triples, and your quads. So you're looking for dice that have a matching pair, that's a double. If there's three of a kind, that's a triple. Four of a kind, that's a quad. And any others that don't have a pair, that's a single. Now those, your doubles, your triples, and your quads, they're going to decide special abilities that you can do later on. Your singles, they can't do special abilities, but the player with the most singles is the one that goes first.
Okay.
So if you're able to do less special moves, you're able to go first. So nice. It's a nice balancing factor. That was Jervis's idea, so can't take that as my own. So you decide that, and then you go launch straight into the combat phase. And in the combat phase is actually where you do all of your moving, all of your fighting, all of your maneuvering, everything takes place. So as mentioned before, the game is alternate activation. And what we mean is, rather than you saying, I go with all of my fighters, I move them all, I fight with them, so on, then the enemy does the same. Instead, I pick just one of my fighters, activate with them, then my opponent chooses one of their fighters and activates with them. When you activate a fighter, they get to do two actions, and there are four actions to choose from. So it's very, very contained. It's really easy to teach someone very quickly. So the four actions that you can do is either move, and move encapsulates climbing, jumping, flying, things like that. Attack, so attack is attacking with both a melee weapon or a ranged weapon. Those are the two actions you're going to be doing most of the time. There's also a wait action, which allows you to delay one of your fighters' turns. They miss one of their actions, but they get to fight later on. So when you're playing objectives, that becomes crucial later on. The last one is a disengage action, which enables you to get out of melee combat with an enemy fighter. So the game plays very, very quickly. Because of the alternate activation, there's no downtime between you and your opponent. It's I like to think of it as being fast, brutal, and tactical. It's the three words that I would use to describe it. So you are having to think on your feet all the time, just like if you are actually fighting in there. You go with one of your fighters, then your opponent reacts and strikes back, something you weren't expecting. You have to react and so on. So it's very, very, very fast moving. Because there's only four actions to choose from, it's very easy to teach a player, a new player, how to play the game quickly. Now, when you activate a fighter, as well as being able to do two actions, you can do one ability as well, if you've got sufficient dice. And each warband has an ability card, and that's got six abilities on it. So every warband is the same. They've got their own unique six abilities, and that's fixed. There's not going to be any more abilities added for those warbands, so that's fixed for them. So for example, the Iron Golems, they can do things like they can throw their boluses, so that a lot of them are equipped with metal boluses. So able to throw their boluses at the enemy. The Ogre Breacher is able to become a living battering ram and charge down one of his opponents. Over on the Untamed Beasts, there's the First Fang, which is the champion with the javelin. He's able to do a harpoon snag where he throws the harpoon into the enemy and pulls them forward. Very handy for pulling them off buildings and things like that. Yeah, in our studio campaign, Kelly, who's playing with the Untamed Beasts, she's been doing lots of shenanigans with this ability, pulling people off a building, into range of the Rock Tusk Prowler, which is the sort of lion creature that the Untamed Beasts have, so it can attack twice. Is one of her specialities. So the game's very quick to play. We'll talk quickly about how you do attack actions.
Sure.
Then we'll probably talk about why we did some of the changes from Age of Sigmar. So an attack action is streamlined compared to Age of Sigmar in the sense that there isn't a hit roll, a wound roll, and a save roll. It's all condensed into a single roll. So what you do is you look at your weapon profile, you check that the fighter is in range. You take a number of dice equal to the attack's characteristic, which will usually be at a minimum two, but most often three or more. And then you compare your strength and toughness. And toughness takes into account the enemy's armor already. So for example, the Iron Golems with the big shields, the Iron Legionnaires, they have a toughness value of 5. So that takes it into account already. And then depending on if you've got a higher strength or a lower strength than your opponent's toughness, that dictates what the dice roll you need. And then there's two damage profiles. So there's a normal hit and there's a critical hit. So you might see on an attack profile, it might say 2-4, for example, for the Drill Master. That indicates a hit and a critical hit. Okay. And that's the amount of damage you're going to be allocating. So if you wanted to do an attack action, we just say the Drill Master for the Iron Golems, you're going to take three dice. You're going to say that her attack is strength 4, so you're going to ask what your opponent's toughness is. Just say their toughness was 3. It means a hit is going to be on a 3 or more. A critical hit's always on an unmodified 6. So you just roll those 3 dice, and then you see how many 6s you've got, how many 3 pluses you've got otherwise. Just say both of them were 3 plus and the last one was a 6. That would do 8 damage in total because it's 2 and 4. So yeah, it's very, very quick to play, and it's very, very quick to learn. Now, when you're looking at a fighter's profile, what we did is we upped the wounds characteristics of all of the fighters. So if you imagine a fighter with 1 wound in Age of Sigmar, they're usually going to have 10 wounds in Warcry. And that's because we're able to really, really zoom in on these fighters and represent them getting injured on sort of a slower basis before they're finally brought down. On the flip side, you do more attacks. So a standard fighter will usually have around 3 attacks, and those attacks will do 1 damage or 3 damage on a critical hit, champions doing more. And what that means is the reason for doing this is we looked at Age of Sigmar Skirmish, and we thought about the way the core rules for Age of Sigmar translates into a skirmish game. And just say you took a standard human fighter, like a Free Guild swordsman. They hit on 4s, they wound on 4s, then the enemy has a save roll, and it does 1 damage. So the hitting on 4s, wounding on 4s, means you've got a 25% chance of getting an attack through, mm-hmm. which means over the course of 4 turns, you're likely to do 1 attack. And then your opponent might save it. So you might have a fighter that does absolutely nothing throughout the game. So what we wanted here is with Kill Team, we're able to make a bespoke rule set to go alongside Warhammer 40,000. And that worked really well to sort of focus, to change the Warhammer 40,000 rules and develop them to make them more appropriate for a skirmish setting. For Warcry, we decided to take that even further. So we built a lot of the mechanics from the ground up again. And the attack sequence and the amount of wounds that characters have is a direct result of this. So you can expect any attack sequence that you go through, you're likely to do at least 1 point of damage to your opponent. You'd have to be very unlucky to whiff everything. It does happen from time to time, but still. But then on the flip side, your fighters have got much more wounds. So what you'll see is they take wounds over the battle, and they're slowly brought down by, tough fighters can be brought down by multiple small fighters and things like that without relying on a lucky hit getting through. So that was some of the work that we did into redesigning the mechanics for Warcry.
It sounds very much like the cinematic sort of gameplay that you'd want, a bit like we were talking about the movement and interacting with walls and jumping and climbing. You don't want to imagine these terrifying chaos warriors flailing and missing effectively. The idea of them taking lumps off each other but still standing and gritting their
teeth. Exactly. You can feel each blow as well. So each hit, each critical hit, it really feels the damage, and you see your fighters get more injured as you play through the game. It means the game comes with a lot of damage tokens. Mm-hmm. One of the cool things we did about the tokens is, firstly, because you've got your fighter cards, you can always put your tokens onto your fighter cards, so that's nice. Sometimes you'll have fighters that share the same fighter card. So for example, with the Untamed Beasts, you get 3 Planeswunners in the core box. You come with 1 fighter card for the Planeswunners because they've all got the same statistics. But there is a divider card that you can place underneath that's got sections 1, 2, and 3. So if you perhaps number, I've got Ben Johnson, for example, he puts a little number on the base of his fighters that share the same fighter card. You can then match your tokens there. Alternatively, if you want to put your tokens on the table, things like the damage counters, because so many of them go down, we gave each of them a little pointed tip. Mm-hmm. So you're able to point them at the character that's being affected by them. So when you've got a big swirling melee happen, you're able to quickly identify who's taken what damage.
Very smart.
Yeah.
Cool. It feels like there's lots of learnings have been taken on board from recent games, but also some of the more established skirmish games of the past.
So we took everything on board from, you know, we looked right the way back from the Slaves to Darkness and Lost in the Damned books for the Realm of Chaos all the way through to Age of Sigmar Skirmish and Kill Team, and tried to sort of incorporate the best bits from everything and try and create the best game possible. So the game is very, very fast to play through. Just going over and talking about some of the move actions then. So I spoke about them a little bit before. You can climb up any wall And there is no restriction to how much movement it costs. So you're just able to move straight up any wall. There is ample places for arms to be able to sort of be able to grab on and things like that. You're able to leap from building to building as long as you've got ample move left. So if you've got a move value of 5, you're able to leap 5 inches across. And that just, it makes the game feel really, really exciting and dynamic. And you can just imagine these really fast-paced battles where fighters, you can do cool things like you can leap over an enemy fighter if you're on top of a balcony, and then you can whack them in the back and things like that. So there's lots of very cinematic stuff that happens during a game.
Cool. How long does a typical game take to play?
So a typical game, so when you're first playing it, you'll probably take about an hour and 20 minutes or something like that. That's where the first few games when we were teaching the rules. So once you're up to speed, you can definitely play within an hour. Most of the battles are either 3 or 4 battle rounds. And because of the staggered deployments, you'll have maybe one battle group. So you might have 4 fighters on in the first battle round. You might have 6 in the second, and then you fall 8 or 9 in the last one. So the games are very, very quick. Often you will be able to do something straight away. So there won't, the first battle round isn't sacrificed to, I'm going to move all my guys up, you're going to move all your guys up. We start right ready where the first punches are being thrown. So often it's unwise, but you can just launch straight into the enemy and try and hit them straight away with your first attack. Usually results with that one fighter being ganged up on by all of the others. If somebody particularly tanky, like the Ogre Breacher, he can definitely go in and handle himself.
Have any of the players in the studio earned reputations as particularly belligerent players? Is there anyone who always goes for the kill straight away?
Well, yeah, there is. I think the players that are winning the most battles at the moment in our studio campaign is probably Ben Johnson, who's a very good tournament player. So he brings that tactical mind to the way he plays. Also the background writer, Jordan Green. He's surprising. Seems to roll a lot of sixes. Recently in a campaign game, he killed my Ogre Breacher. So my Ogre Breacher, Voss, who is immortalized in this book. I was like, I'm going to write your name down. So there's my example roster at the time is in this book. You were going to live on forever, but no, sadly he died. Jordan is using bone splitters and his big stabber, Scrog and Grog. They stabbed up my Ogre Breacher proper good. So we'll talk about that later in the campaign systems. Sure. But yeah, your fighters can die. So my Ogre Breacher Voss is no more. So that was quite a sad day for me. But that's all right. I'll be able to recruit a new one. He just won't have all of the cool destiny levels and lesser artifacts that Voss used to have. Yes. But that's it's the nature of the Varan Spire and battling in the 8 points. It's tough along the way. So some of your fighters are going to die.
When you were on Stormcast before, you had mentioned your Blades of Corn name generator, which generated a lot of excitement.
Yeah.
How do you come up with names for people in your warbands? Are there examples presented in the book?
Yes, there are. So this is the hard work of Nick Horth, who spent a long time on this. So me and Nick, we were the main writers for this together. So I wrote all of the rules, and I would do a first draft at some of the color text, as we call it, so the evocative text around the rules. But then Nick would go in and polish it all up and make sure it was fantastic. But one of the things he did was generate full name generators for every single warband. And that's not just the core Chaos warbands that are coming with the game. It's also things like your Nighthaunt and your Stormcast Eternals. What's really exciting about it is it's not just your first name and your last name. It also talks about the origin of your warband, and it talks about the background of your leaders and your later on your favored warriors, which we can talk about later. So you get to see why Stormcast Eternals might be hunting down, hunting in the Varan Spire, or why Legions of Nagash might be in there. With the Chaos warbands, looking at the different naming conventions that Nick chose, it's really exciting. Each of them has their own feel, and none of them, you'll see elements of maybe real world cultures that they play homage to slightly, but they'll be twisted and different and have a very Warhammer feel as well. So lots of great work has gone in there. So all of my Iron Golems are named from the name generator.
Cool.
What I like to do is for some of them, like things like my Ogre Breacher, I won't give him a last name. It feels a bit formal if he's got both a first name and a last name, especially because you imagine him to be very big and brutish. So he just gets one name. So he was called Voss before. I'm going to have to choose a new name for my new Ogre Breacher now. But yeah, so my leader, Sever Greel, that's comes from the name Generator. Oh, cool. And he's notorious for knocking people off bridges. That's what he likes to do.
I'm sneaking a look at the name generators, I can see.
So yeah, I've got them on the table in front of us now for the listeners.
And they've got D10 tables, which are always exciting to see in a Games Workshop book, yeah. Which we saw in Kill Team. Is the gameplay itself D6 based, or do you use other dice in the game as well?
The game is 100% D6 based.
Excellent.
So all of the initiative dice that we talked about before that decide your abilities, all of the attack sequences, all done with D6s. Putting the D10s in here, what we really wanted is more than six options. Yeah. So you don't get any D10s in the box. But if you've got access to a D10, you are able to roll them on here. If you've just got D6s, you can just use two dice and discard elements of 11 and 12. You will get a lot of sevens though, so a lot of Splintered Fang being called a Synth and things like that. But these for these generators, we always want them to be inspiration, so they're never gospel. They're, for some players, they like to just roll up the names and that's what it's like. For other players, they'll roll it and say, no, that's not the name that I want to give the character, and they'll keep rolling it until they find one that they do like, or maybe they'll start twisting them and evolving them. So I think that's when we did them for Kill Team, I think it was one of the most exciting things in there, seeing all of the different names. And I loved just rolling up different ideas for my Gene Stealer cults that I loved to play in Kill Team, and it was the same thing here. So you get full name generators for all of the factions that have campaigns in this book, so there's lots and lots of content in here. So it's really exciting to look at.
I'm sure we'll talk about the campaigns in just a moment, but I was thinking it was a very nice feature that we saw in the most recent version of Necromunda, where the gangs were all very different from the beginning, whereas formerly you had to wait till you got into a campaign and the skills you could pick make them different. But knowing that there's two warbands, in the Warcry box that play differently from the beginning, that's great. And then you can choose, I'm sure, to play the Iron Golem differently from one warband to another, or a different Iron Golem.
If you're a player of Necromunda and you love the Goliaths, I think the Iron Golem are going to be right up your street. And same if you like the Escher, I think the playstyle of the Untamed Beasts would definitely appeal to you. Alternatively, you might want to try the other tropes. So it's very much that sort of heavy armored, slow and brutish versus that fast and agile, which always makes such an exciting dynamic core box, which is why we chose those two warbands to be facing off against each other in the core box.
So we should talk about the campaigns in a little bit more detail then. So this, I know from my chats with you about this is one of the most exciting bits about this book, because it feels like, for games like Mordheim and Necromunda, that post-battle sequence where you were, as a narrative player, imagining the tribulations that your group of fighters was going through, this feels like it's been really well realized as an aspect of that game.
So inside the core book, you've got open play, narrative play, and match play, and you've got full sections on each. I think for a lot of players, it's the narrative play and the campaigns that's going to be the real lure of the game for them. It's the being able to grow your warband from sort of green fighters, sort of fresh stepped onto the soils of the Bloodwind Spoil, through to hardened veterans that have fought their way to the gates of the Baron Spire, I think is going to be the most exciting aspect for a lot of players. And it's going to be tough. Your fighters are going to die along the way, but they're going to get stronger, they're going to level up, they're going to get abilities, they're going to get treasure, artifacts, command traits, and things like that, so that by the end you really feel like the ones that have survived have really been through it and come out as the toughest fighters as a result. So yeah, I think it's going to be very exciting. So inside the book, so the book is 160 pages in total, and the last 80 pages or so are basically dedicated to your campaigns. So it starts on page 80, and then this includes all of the narrative play as well. So let's just quickly go through how the campaign system works. You can have a total of 20 fighters in your warband roster as a total. And we'll talk about some of the differences and why we did them to our older systems in a little bit.
Sure.
But you don't need to worry about the points costs of them. So you don't have a hard set limit to begin with. You can add as many fighters to your warband roster as you want. But then when it comes to playing a game, you will choose 1,000 points from that roster to play your game. So you can have a warband roster of just 1,000 points, or you could have it of as many points as you want.
Have some redundancy built in.
Yeah, exactly. And as we'll talk about later, there's ways to slowly have a bigger warband inside the campaign games, and that's where you might want to start growing your roster. So you add your fighters to your warband roster, and to do that, you give them a nice evocative name, maybe using the generator. And then after that, you want to choose your campaign quest. So really, the heart and soul of the campaign system is the quest that you choose to embark upon. So a large section of the book is devoted to these quests. Now, if you're playing one of the Chaos Warbands specifically designed for Warcry, say the Iron Golem or the Untamed Beasts, you get two different quests to choose from in here. If you're playing one of the Age of Sigmar factions that has rules for Warcry, you've got a single quest in here. With Warcry moving forward, there's going to be more quests added that everybody can take part in. Excellent. So you're going to have lots and lots of content. So what does a campaign quest look like? So I'm just flicking through the book. So I'm going to go to the first one, Conquer the Forge. So this is one for the Iron Golems. So the campaign quests are chosen by the faction icon up in the top corner, so you can see the portcullis symbol for the Iron Golems there. So this is, if you're familiar with playing computer games or playing tabletop RPGs, things like that, you'll be familiar with embarking on quests. It's the heart and soul of a lot of RPGs and things like that. And we brought that into here. So you choose for your quest, which is the main story that your guys are going on. So for the Iron Golems, they have heard of a very powerful forge out in the Eight Points with this campaign quest. They are going to dominate it. They're going to kill everybody inside, and they're going to take it for their own. And they're going to use that as a basis of operations to start creating weapons for the Varangard and things like that. So you get a bit of evocative text up at the top, which tells you the story, what you're embarked upon, what your goals are. And then you see that there are three convergences. Now, these are fixed battles that you will play at certain points. So for most of the games that you play, we'll just be using the battlefield cards, as we discussed before, so a randomly generated battle. But at certain points, called convergences, you will have a fixed battle that you need to play through to be able to progress. And again, each of these has a very evocative story about what's going on, and then it shows you the full battle plan, so the map where you're fighting, who you're fighting against, and so on. So as me and Nick were working on these together, the one thing that I wanted was, from all of this narrative prose, was for it to be in second person. So it talks about, you have come to this land, you are going to conquer this forge, you have been beset upon by ambushes, you are going to take out the Chaos Dwarden that rules this forge. And so,
the what, sorry?
The Chaos Dwarden.
Okay, yes. Yeah, good.
You're going to take out the Chaos Dwarden who runs this forge, and so on. So it's it feels very immersive. It feels like you're taking part in here. Once you've chosen your warband, you'll be choosing a quest for you to play upon. Okay, and then you start playing your campaign games. And to play your campaign game, you're just playing a game using the battlefield cards to generate a battle. And you're going to be, to start off with, you're going to be playing with 1,000 points drawn from your warband roster. Now, after each battle, there is something called the aftermath sequence.
Such a good name.
Yeah. So it harkens back to the old post-battle sequence. I think the aftermath sequence, it's got a bit more gravitas, hasn't it, than post-battle.
Sounds like a messier battle.
So in the aftermath sequence, what you're going to do is you're going to earn glory for your fighters. So depending on how well you did in the battle, you're going to be earning glory points. And then with those glory points, you might choose to dominate areas of territory. So for the Chaos Warbands, this is where they raise their monoliths. For things like the Stormcast Eternals, they might be doing sort of a blessing sanctify the land around them and things like that. So different ways of dominating your territory. But what that means in future games is you're going to be able to bring another 50 points. So you will, if you can dominate up to 6 pieces over the course of a campaign. So you might be bringing 1,300 points versus an opponent's 1,000. So you're not able to get a massive advantage like you were in the older games, but you are able to get a small advantage going forward. Once you've acquired your glory points, you need to make injury rolls for your characters, and some of them, unfortunately, are going to die.
Like Voss.
Yeah, like Voss by Ogre Breacher. In my last game as well, I played against Jordan, and my drill master, Varka, she also died. I actually made, you're less likely to die in here than you are in the older, say, Mordheim, where it was on a roll of a 1, essentially, wasn't it? Because it was a D66 table with 11 to 16 being the dead result. Here it's 2D6. 6 on a 2-3, so it's only an 8% or 8.33% chance of happening, but I seem to roll it an awful lot for my fighters. So fighters can get slain or fighters can lose favor, and we'll talk about that in a sec. Then for your fighters that have survived the battle, they weren't taken down, you're able to roll a dice to see if they accrue a destiny level. So this is the leveling up system here, so it's very, very easy and quick to get into. So you roll a dice for each of those fighters, and on a 6 they earn a destiny level. Fighters can have anywhere between 1-3 destiny levels, and what a destiny level gives you is, in your next battle, it lets you re-roll one of your hit rolls, and that spends that destiny level just for that battle. Doesn't take it away from your fighter, just uses it up for that battle, so it's like a small resource. Okay. Similar to command points. Yeah. in Age of Sigmar. Now if you going back to the injury rolls, if you weren't slain, perhaps you got lost favor, which means if you had a destiny level, it would have removed it as well. So you'll see that fluctuate up and down rather than always going up. Once you've done that, you get to my favorite part of the aftermath sequence, which is searching for lesser artifacts. So we've got a great table, a D66 table of all kinds of different trinkets and devices that your fighters might find. And this represents stuff that they might barter from in the markets of Khangard. It represents stuff that they might find in the ruins of the wilderness. You know, if they're not, maybe Nighthaunt won't roll into the markets of Khangard to see what they can find. Mm. So you get to search for lesser artifacts. These were really, really fun to put together, me and Nick working on these, because it gives a real, a very sort of gritty, low-down look at what magic might look like for the everyday person inside the Mortal Realms. So for example, you might get a jar of Chamonic Glowflies, which is, they're able to bring luck to your fighter and so on. Or you might get the Raven Feather Necklace, which makes your fighter a bit more hitty, a bit more attacky, I think is the scientific term. Vial of Javas Life Blood, things like that. Now, some of these artifacts they're either consumable or perishable. A consumable is like, for example, a healing potion that you get, you use it once and then it's gone. A perishable one offers a permanent effect to your fighter, but at the end of each battle it might run out of its magical properties. So on a 1, 2, or 3 it loses its magical properties. So you're going to be picking up these lesser artifacts as you play through the campaign, and that's going to give a real distinct feel to your warband, and it's going to lead to some interesting sort of situations where I've got my sort of Chaos Dwarden in my Iron Golem, some Haddon, who's incredibly slow with a move of 3. So whenever I get something like Swift Wind Dust, I always give it to him so he can sort of consume the Swift Wind Dust on the first battle round, give him a little bit more speed throughout the game. So there's lots of exciting things. I think people are going to enjoy the sort of the background element of this. Yeah. As well. It should be really exciting for them.
It's more showing what there is in the Mortal Realms, not show, don't tell. Yeah. So these things exist and people make use of them and work out how they got there.
Yeah. And then after that, you've got your campaign progress tracker. So this represents the map. It represents the warriors moving through the wilderness, the wastes of the Bloodwind Spoil, approaching their campaign goal. So there are 12 points on the map in total, and on each normal game, you will automatically progress 1 point. But there are certain points along, so the 3rd, the 5th, and the 11th, that are marked as convergences. And that takes us back to what I mentioned before, the 3 set piece battles. Mm. So for most of the part, you complete a game, you progress, then at certain points, you have to play one of your convergences to be able to progress. Okay. You're not compelled to play that that convergence. You can just play a normal game if you want. For example, I got badly beaten last week on my convergence. With my new Iron Golems Warband that I've just started. And I've decided that I'm going to lick my wounds, I think, play a few normal games, maybe try and build up my glory, dominate a few more areas of territory so I can bring more fighters when I next try it. Mm-hmm. But if you do want to progress along the map, you are going to have to play these convergences at certain points. But when you do complete them, you are awarded either an artifact of power or a command trait. So an artifact of power is it's a magical weapon, as you know from Age of Sigmar. This is something that doesn't lose its power. It's imbued with magical energy, so you will have it for the rest of the campaign, as long as the fighter wielding it doesn't die. And the same thing for your command trait as well. Command traits go to your leader in first, and that is a permanent ability that they have. So your leader, for example, is going to become very powerful over the course of the campaign. Now, what's interesting is when you play through the campaign, and you complete the campaign. What we imagine is, and playing through it ourselves, is that your warband roster, once you get to the end of a campaign, you've got usually five or six areas of dominated territory, so you're bringing a few more points than your opponent is to the game, unless they spend glory on reinforcements. So you feel nice and powerful, but you're going to have these artifacts of power, and you'll have two by the end of the campaign. And one of them is going to have to go on a fighter who's not your leader, and leaders aren't susceptible to being slain because they're destined for greatness, but your other fighter is, which means that artifact of power is a ticking time bomb, really. It's going to go at some point. So if you want more artifacts and more command traits, you're going to have to embark upon a new quest. And when you embark upon a new quest, the idea is you leave behind the land that you've conquered so far, because you need to go to another place in the Bloodwind Spoil to do so. So you end up losing all of your dominated territories. You take all of the fighters with you, the destiny levels that they've gained, all the equipment that they've got, but you go back down to zero dominated territories. So what this means is, over the course of playing multiple campaign quests within your group, there'll be an ebb and flow. There'll be peaks and troughs on when you're bringing more fighters than your opponent, or when you're bringing less fighters, and so on. One of the things that we wanted to do is look back at the older campaign systems for things like Mordheim, the original Necromunda, and in game design we talk about positive feedback loops and negative feedback loops. And if you're not familiar with the term, a positive feedback loop is when the output informs the input. Mm-hmm. Put that in layman's, it means a win spiral is a positive feedback loop. Because you're winning, your warband gets stronger, so it's more likely to win your next game. The same thing with a death spiral. So you lose, you're doing worse in your next game, eventually it spirals out of control. So what we wanted to do was try and solve that problem. So that's why, for example, you're able to recruit as many new fighters to recover your losses as need be. You don't need to pay points or things like that to recruit new fighters. They the suffering, or the dent that happens to your warband, the blow they suffer, is that they lose, you know, any destiny levels, any treasure, things like that. So Voss, you know, he had two destiny levels, he's lost them both. My new Ogre Breacher won't be as tough as Voss, but I will never dip below 1,000 points when I play a game. I'm always able to bring 1,000 points. And what that means is, if your warband takes a few early losses, you need not worry. But for the players that are doing well, eventually their good fighters will die, so it helps balance it out and keeps sort of an equilibrium is what we wanted. So that's some of the idea behind the design of the system.
It's a very elegant system, because I think with games like Necromunda and Mordheim, essentially get rich. That's why you're there. You're just trying to get rich, yep, and there wasn't much framework beyond that.
Yeah, it does. There is definitely an allure and a bit of some verisimilitude to that sort of crunch. If your warbands, they've lost loads of members, they need to lick their wounds. But at the same time, if you lose really, really badly, sometimes you just want to stop playing with that warband and start again. So what we wanted is, we didn't want the losers to be so dramatic for the player. We wanted everything to be on a much sort of tighter scope. So if you're winning, you get benefits. If you're losing and you've acquired some stuff, it will reset you back to zero. But you're always able to play on pretty much a level footing. Yeah. So you never feel like you're totally at a loss before the game's even begun.
You don't have that runaway leader syndrome.
Yeah, exactly. That's the sort of thing we wanted to stop. Yeah. So positive feedback loops can be really good, for example, in a game, helping make sure victory is decisive. But in terms of a campaign, the things that you want to try and stop, because runaway leader in a campaign is not great, because it can lead to, you're playing a campaign for such a long time, you want it to be more even throughout the course.
It can be underwhelming, I think, for the player who's out in the lead, because if no one else wants to play against them, and the victories all feel a bit hollow, it feels like everything's going to be much more closely matched and balanced.
And hopefully, so even if a player is doing really well, what they'll do is they'll try and do new challenges by embarking on new campaign quests and going back down to zero dominated territories at that point.
And you said there were other beasties in the Warcry box that you can make use of when you're expanding your warband as well.
Yeah. So if you just buy the core box, you've got stuff ready to play a campaign straight away. So you've got a warband that clocks in just under 1,000 points, and then as you start dominating pieces of territory, you could either choose to, so you can bring, when you dominate territory, for each piece of dominated territory, you can thrall one of the chaotic beasts to your warband, if you're a chaos warband. So you thrall one of the chaos beasts, for example, a Fury or a Raptrix, and then that plays in your, it fights alongside with you. It doesn't gain levels in the same way, and you might not even name it. The idea, it might not even be the same fury each time, for example. It's just one of them has had its mind enthralled by the dark powers of the monolith that your warband has raised. And so you can play a campaign with the contents in the box because you're able to start adding in the Furies and Raptorixes into your warband to account for the extra points you're able to bring. So each area of dominated territory gives you 50 extra points. So what you might find is with some of the points that you've got left over, you might be able to get a Fury in with your first piece of dominated territory, because Furies are about, I think they're 75 points. So that gets you in on that 50 points plus any you have left over.
For players who are going to be picking up Warcry, I guess, shortly after this goes out, what advice would you give anyone?
My advice would be really get into the spirit of your warband. Read through the two campaign quests that each of them have available. Decide which one really appeals to you, because that's what you're going to be spending a lot of your time doing. As you're playing through the convergences, when you play one of these set piece battles, read out to your opponent your story so far. Really helps set the scene. I think getting into the spirit of it is going to be something that players are going to reap the rewards off that.
Sounds like you're suggesting costumes. That's what I'm hearing, that you should dress up in appropriate costumes.
Yeah, I think if you customise maybe a diving helmet, you might be able to make an appropriate Iron Golem's helmet, which would be quite fun, wouldn't it? I'd really get into the spirit of it. There are things like with the artifacts of power and the command traits that your warband will earn, you can either pick or roll. I am a diehard roller for the for a campaign. I think it's great to see the randomness that you might get, rather than always going for the most optimal build. I think so. What's been interesting is with the studio campaign is seeing people when they fail a convergence and then they sit down and give it a good long think about their tactics and what they did, and then when they approach it the second time, maybe they've played a few battles in between and helped sort of gain more treasure and things like that, they're generally able to overcome it the second time. So one of the interesting things is I mentioned before that you split up your battle groups and you don't know what the scenario is going to be. When you're playing one of the convergences, you have known elements. You might know what the deployment's going to be or know what the twist is going to be. So then you can set your battle group so you could load as many fighters into the dagger as possible, if the dagger's going to be the first thing on. You can really think about your tactics for that battle and try and sort of skew it to your advantage.
Cool. Okay. Yeah. And what sort of things are you looking forward to seeing when the community gets their hands on Warcry?
I'm really looking forward to seeing people taking the existing Age of Sigmar factions and converting, kit bashing their warriors to show what they might look like. So for example, if you take, just say you're playing the Stormcast Eternals with the Vanguard Chamber models that you're able to take, I want to see, you know, the Vanguard that look like they've been fighting a campaign behind enemy lines in the 8 points for a number of months, what that would look like. It might be sort of streaks of rust and damage and rain smears going down their armor. It might be scars across their face, because these guys, you know, they don't want to die. They don't want to get teleported back to Azir, because then it would have been such a mission and a half just to get into the 8 points itself. So they're desperate to stick around as much as everyone else. And so I'm really looking forward to seeing those conversions and things like that.
It'll be a very different lens to look at those existing factions through.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm very excited. Yep. Everything I've heard confirms that this is truly going to be my absolute favourite Warhammer game ever. I think.
Brilliant.
So thank you very much for taking the time to give us this very comprehensive explanation. I also am looking forward to seeing what happens when people get hold of it.
Yeah, I hope everybody is excited. There's going to be lots of exciting content for Warcry moving forward as well. So you can get into this, you can be hyped, and you can expect lots of cool things to come.
Great stuff. Well, thanks again for this, and thank you for your
time.
Thank
you for having me, Wade.
Cheers. Thanks again to Sam, and thank you for watching or listening to the podcast. Stormcast will return in another 2 weeks' time, and there will be a new episode of Voxcast released next week. You can also check out the Warhammer TV Facebook page for details of other TV shows that we do, or to leave us any feedback you have about the podcasts. You can also download every episode from stormcastpodcast.com. We'll see you soon.